Welcome back to the PFC podcast. The views and opinions you are about to hear are the speakers and do not necessarily reflect those of anyone else. Now on to the podcast.
Welcome back to the PFC podcast. This is Dennis, and today I'm talking with Ricky and Justin on their new paper for administration of calcium in hemorrhagic shock. How are you guys doing?
Good, man. Thanks for having me. Yeah, I'm Ricky. I actually just transitioned off of active duty, and I help over at the Special Operations Medic Coalition with the research education team. And then we got my buddy Justin here.
Yep, I'm Justin. I'm a medic on active duty with USASOC right now.
Awesome. So, you know, what started you guys down this path?
So I'm going to give my little perspective, and then I'll let Justin jump in on his. So I actually asked Justin before going on clinical rotations when he was one of my instructors about, you know, calcium and clotting. And he came back and was like, yeah, I mean, you know, it's in the cascade. And then we do it for citrate toxicity. And I was like, huh, that's pretty cool. And, you know, me and my other buddy, Alex, we were like, man, that's pretty cool. Like, you know, citrate toxicity, it's crazy that we think about something like that. You know, as a brand new medic into that field, it's knowledge like that, super exciting. So I went off the rotations, and then I encountered a patient who ended up going to disseminated intravascular coagulopathy, or DIC is what most people hear it as. And, you know, it really bothered me that she was doing so poorly. She wouldn't respond to blood products. She was crashing. It was just one of those experiences that make you think. And so I got really deep in the literature. I wanted to understand why she didn't clot, or what are some of the contributing factors to DIC, and came up that, hey, calcium's super involved in the clotting cascade, kind of like Justin had told me, and maybe that citrate in the blood wasn't helping. Maybe that was the problem. You know, back then that's all I could think of as a primary cause. But when I got into the physiology, it just didn't seem like a citrate problem. And so I want to kind of go deeper in that. So I kind of came back and thought about this topic some more. I remember bringing it up to Justin again, being like, hey, I had this bad patient. What could we have done different? Could we have given her calcium? And he's like, yeah, you know, once again, you know, we do it for citrate, or what have you. And I was like, oh, sweet. So like, once again, like super pumped, like, hey, this is in our protocols. This is something I'm going to be doing when I graduate from this place. And so between that time and then in processing my next organization, you know, I did what most guys do. I got on the computer, you know, started looking at physiology, started finding more and more evidence physiologically that this is more than a citrate problem. I only found a study here and there, and I really just happened it from a physiologic perspective. And then I went to my regional surgeon, was like, hey man, hey sir, but you know, like, hey man, I got this idea. What if we gave calcium earlier, because it's so important for clotting? Could it help keep guys alive? And he was like, well, I don't know. Look it up. You know, there hasn't been a new idea since 1776. And I'm sure somebody out there is already working on this, which we're reflecting is awesome, because he didn't just say no. He was, you know, as a regional surgeon, he was just like, go for it. So that's what I did. You know, I called my other buddy. I was super pumped. He's also a student that I was at the school with, and he was like, man, you got to do something about that. So, you know, fast forward to looking into literature and stuff, came to a presentation opportunity at my unit, and I had built a presentation that some guys have seen at SOMA, but first I just built it for an informative brief as part of my pipeline. And I gave that brief, and then my unit was like, hey, you can go to SOMA for this. But instead, I got in contact with some guys up at George Washington University and ended up going to the CTEC meeting about it. So at that point, I was kind of getting traction, and I was figuring out that I was kind of onto something, but there's no chance that I could do any of that stuff alone. So between the people I bounced the ideas off of, like, I'm sure Dennis, I don't know if you remember, but I actually messaged you on the LMS server and asked you this really crazy in-depth physiologic question about phospholipase A2 and COX inhibitors and all that. I remember your response was, wow, maybe you should probably talk to like a trauma surgeon. And I thought that was, and at the time I was super pumped about that because I was like, because you're one of the guys who's super smart, took a lot away from you as one of my instructors. And I was like, man, you know, at the top, back then it was, you know, it was Mr. Duramos. I was like, oh, Mr. Duramos, he thinks I'm on to something. So I got to keep looking. And so I messaged someone like Aaron Geetson. I wrote Aaron Geetson the same thing, super long paragraphs worth of information. And Mr. Geetson comes back and he's like, you know, deep physiologic answer where it could make sense physiologically. But he was like, you need to talk to a trauma surgeon. And I was like, dang, I got to talk to a trauma surgeon. So I reached out to a bunch of people that I thought were way smarter than me throughout the whole process. And I think that's like a key takeaway about this. And then I realized it was going to take a team to get the thing settled. So after presenting at CTEC, some mentors of mine were like, this needs research. We need a literature review. And I don't have a college degree. At that time, I really didn't understand research process. I didn't know anything of what a lit review meant. So we kind of formed a team. So I brought on a buddy of mine, Will Eisenhart, who's one of my best mentors that I know. He brought on his buddy, Sung Hyuk, who's another great mentor of mine, and actually just recently matched in Harvard for Gen Surg residency. We brought on one of my buddies, Cody Rankin, another really smart guy that I knew could help. And then, you know, without me doing it, Will reached out to Justin and was like, hey, we're going to need your help on this project. And then I talked to Will and I was like, hey, we're going to bring Justin Anderson on board. And I was like, all right, let's talk to Justin. So I'll let Justin talk about his piece of being on the team. But the big takeaway here is we saw, and I say we as the team, because we all agreed to this, we saw there's a gap in medicine. And we came up to this collective goal that, hey, if this has the potential to help bring guys home, then we're going to pursue it. If we're wrong, that's okay. But until we do the research, we're not going to be okay with being wrong and or guessing that we're still right. So bringing someone like Justin who had a better understanding and knowledge of the research world is really helpful. So he kind of spun up the lit review team. So I'll let Justin kind of give his side of the story there.
Yeah, I mean, Ricky really hit kind of a lot of the high points, even from my end. He was my student, and there's a couple trends here. One, Ricky would ask very deep physiologic questions at a very early stage. He used to come over, he and Alex both, and would ask me what receptor this particular drug is acting on, why doesn't this antibiotic have any mechanism of action against this organism? A lot of really deep questions that made me think, and I was really thankful for it. And then one day he asked me, talking through the clotting cascade. I laughed because I'm not going to lie. I can't talk you through the entire clotting cascade off the top of my head, especially while I'm teaching something else. So I told him I'd print it off and I'd hand it to him. And excuse me, we could talk about it, you know, once he goes through it. And so he looks at the clotting cascade and he's like, yeah, if, you know, there's a lot of calcium on here. And I was like, absolutely. And it just so happened that we were going over whole blood transfusion that afternoon, which is where the whole conversation he had mentioned about calcium administration for citrate toxicity came up. And he started asking, like, well, if we gave calcium earlier, would it help? Because it's in the clotting cascade anyway, which is why it helps here. And if we're getting it, like, why not give it earlier? Which brings us to our second trend. I told Ricky, that's a good question. Look it up back to me. So he's gotten a couple of those. And then he had the DIC patient, and we talked about it when he came back shortly before he graduated. Same conversation he'd already mentioned. And then fast forward, Will was in touch with me and mentions this thing that's going on and starting the research. And then I talked to Ricky, and he essentially says, hey, man, so I looked it up, and I think we're onto something. And he had, you know, two or three studies at that point that kind of all pointed the same direction. And so we were like, well, we need to set up some research. In my mind, I was like, the only way to get anybody to want to do this is if we justify it. And so without really even knowing 100% what I was doing, I did a lit review of the available literature that we could find as our justification for the research that we proposed. And we had taken it up to the contacts that he'd mentioned over at George Washington. And they were like, man, this is really good. You should probably publish this. We're like, well, publish what? Like the review portion, the whole background, like you should publish that. That's a literature review. And so, yeah, we just kind of figured it from there. Decided to just start high and work our way down with the journals. Got an immediate rejection from NIJM,
the New England Journal of Medicine, never even read the article. They didn't even like the pre-submission inquiry. And then our next journal, Journal of Trauma, was all about it. And we just went through that whole process and just stayed strong. And the more we started to look into it and write and research and everything else, the more we realized that there are gaps in knowledge, as Ricky said. And a lot of people wanted to jump on different trends with the calcium without really having a for sure answer whether or not it impacts patient mortality or not. And that was the big question we want to answer. There's only so far lab values can take us. Let's see if it saves lives.
Right. So, I mean, of that whole story, you know, what really kind of fascinates me is that, you know, why did you pick calcium out of everything in the lethal triad? You pick specifically calcium to research.
That's a really good question. The reason I picked calcium was because it was just, to me, it was physiologically correct. And Dennis, I've talked to you about this in person multiple times since I've graduated and stuff, when we've hung out. When I took AMP at the course, you and Aaron Geetson were always bringing back to physiology, whether we're talking about, you know, chain Stokes respirations in a patient with a head injury from your vignette and why it's so important to understand cellular respiration. And, you know, Geetson going on his rants about why it's so important to understand kidney physiology. And that just kind of stuck out to me. It's like, I got to understand those building blocks because they make the larger product. So when I was looking at the cascade, like Justin said, on paper, and just seeing like, yo, there's calcium here, I cross-referenced that in my brain. It just popped in. It was like, you need calcium for the heart to function. And I was like, I remember them saying that there's a calcium-induced calcium release in the heart. And I was like, oh, man, if you're low on calcium and bleeding, I wonder if your low on calcium stops your heart. So then I was like, let me check out traumatic arrest. And I just kept going into different disciplines of medicine because, you know, a lot of people keep cardiac separate from hemorrhage, and we'll look at hemorrhage from one lens, and then we'll look at cardiac through a different lens, and we'll look at, you know, kidneys in a different lens. But when we blur them and call it trauma, you know, we put it all in one microscope, but we still only see it from a different perspective. So what I was trying to do is it just kept popping up, and as weird as it sounds, it just made sense. I was like, this is something I feel like we could be giving because you're losing it. So can we give it was really the first question. And then once I realized that it could help stabilize the myocardium, and we dug a little bit more in the literature, initially for me, it was like, okay, it's super important, the clotting cascade, and it helps stabilize myocardium. Let's take this from a traumatic arrest perspective. Let's prevent traumatic arrest. And then the other thing that really, really set things off was when Colonel Andre Kapp gave a presentation, and I happened to catch the video of it, and he said, if there's any gap we have in damage control resuscitation, it's the use of calcium. And if there's anything that might prevent irreversible shock, it's probably calcium. And then he just clicked next slide. And the audience during his presentation, out of all the questions I asked in the audience, nobody brought that up. And I thought that that was such a profound statement to be coming from the chief hematologist. You know, irreversible is a pretty powerful word. So we kind of just took that's, I know it's a long answer for your question, but that's like why I grasped onto the calcium thing, because it was such a gap, and we wanted to highlight that gap.
You know, after, you know, reading through the paper, you know, a large portion of it is talking about citrate toxicity, massive transfusions, things like that. You know, if citrate is the problem, can we just either get very low citrate bags or no citrate bags for when we do our blood transfusions? Because in the field, I'm only doing a couple. I'm not doing lots of them.
Yeah, so citrate, it isn't the entire problem by any means, but it does have a major impact. So we all knew physiologically that citrate chelates calcium. It's the whole reason it's used as an anticoagulant in the blood bag, so you're not just filling a bag full of a giant clot. The surprising thing about the research was actually that it wasn't the only problem, and that patients were already hypocalcemic before they ever started receiving blood products. The literature that we had reviewed actually suggested that over half of trauma patients expecting to receive a transfusion are already hypocalcemic by the time they arrive at the emergency department. And then once they're already low and then they start receiving blood, that number has jumped up as far as percentage of patients suffering from hypocalcemia. As high as 97% is seen in the Giancarelli study. And so this is likely due to the rate of transfusion being greater than the liver of a trauma patient can metabolize the citrate. So that free-floating citrate from the blood bag is chelating all the ionized calcium that's floating around in the body. And so just worsening this condition and driving hypocalcemia. As far as low citrate bags, that's not that there are any low citrate bags specifically, because you need a certain amount to prevent the blood from clotting, right? But whole blood, stored whole blood, has less citrate as compared to like packed red blood cells. So whole blood stored with CPDA1 has 1.66 grams of citrate, and whole blood stored with CPD has 0.921 grams of sodium citrate. Now, the reason you'll see CPDA1 more nowadays is just because it has a longer shelf life. So just when you happen to compare the two, generally now we'll start to see CPDA1. And then that's compared to, you know, packed red blood cells, which have 3 grams of citrate per unit. And just so everyone here can hear it, a healthy adult liver can metabolize approximately 3 grams of citrate in 5 minutes. And that's a healthy, non-traumatic patient, right? So as you start to push more and more units, then obviously they're going to fall behind in metabolizing that. The Cornbliss study that we cited showed that whole blood was superior to reconstituted whole blood and hemostatic potential in patients. And while there are other factors in play, the difference in the citrate quantities that a patient would be receiving between whole blood versus reconstituted or blood products can absolutely play a part in that.
Later on in the paper, you mentioned that, you know, hypocalcemia is correlated with increased mortality. Was there any evidence of that there was some kind of causation, like increased estimated blood loss, you know, things like that? Because what I didn't see in the research was that from the trauma-related, so before they received any transfusion, I didn't see anything about did they receive those same patients, did they receive crystalloid infusion? Is there anything that says that there is a increased amount of blood loss from hypocalcemia?
So, yeah, great. Yeah, awesome question. And something that I'm going to bring up some points for some of the listeners, because I didn't know what some of those words that you just mentioned meant when I even started this project. So for someone to be causative, especially in research, you have to have the gold standard would be a randomized control trial where the patients are randomized. You have a control group, you have a testing group. If it's double blinded, which is even better, then you have, you know, a staff that doesn't know if they're given the placebo or the actual medication. And then you have the patient, which doesn't know if they're receiving the treatment or the actual medication. That'd be the gold standard. And that's how you prove causation in research, which is then what really drives true protocol change and safety for patients. And then associative is just saying, hey, there's data here that associates these things together, but they're not causative, which is what Dennis is referencing. And honestly, like I said, when I started this three years ago now, I had no clue that there was a real difference in there, because you really don't get taught it. So to bring back to the question, I have not seen data specifically that has analyzed the incidence of hypocalcemia induced from crystalloid infusion in pre-hospital medicine. Personally, I have not seen it. However, we discussed that in the CTEC and the SOMA meeting presentations, where we, you know, there's data that says it'll make, you know, to use electrolytes up, and it's worsening blood clotting and what have you. So we talked about saying, hey, instead of giving crystalloids pre-hospital, we could give calcium pre-hospital, and that would be better continuity of care if you know this patient's going to receive blood transfusion in hospital, because you don't have blood in a lot of civilian pre-hospital ambulances. The other thing about causative data in general for this topic is there has not been a prospective study completed yet. There are some in the works. We've talked to the guys that are working on some of those projects. It's super exciting. But that was the real driving factor to what we're doing with this paper, was to drive prospective research to get a causative answer. And what we're really looking at is, like what Justin said, is to see all-cause mortality reduction. Does that answer your question? Or
oh, yeah, absolutely. And I mean, obviously, awesome. You're very successful because they've added it into the treatment protocol already.
I also would like to throw in there really quick, the Magnotti study. Magnotti, I apologize if he listens to this. I'm not exactly sure how to say your name. He did identify those with low calcium, which he defined as less than 1 mmol/L on admission to an emergency department. It was associated with increased need for multiple and massive transfusions. So while there's not necessarily blood loss correlated to that per se, it's a good predictor, and he actually said a useful independent predictor for the need for multiple transfusions on trauma patients.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. If they need more transfusion, you're assuming that they're still leaking from somewhere, right?
Right. And the other key important piece to bring up, like, since we're citing a lot of the research, like, there's a study by Ho and Leonard that we referenced too. That's one of our kind of favorites. And they even said that hypocalcemia, low ionized calcium level, was independently more important in determining mortality and need for transfusion than acidosis, fibrinogen concentration, and those two factors in, like, determining linear mortality in patients in the ED. So while their stuff was still retrospective and not prospective, you know, even they conclude that hypocalcemia was an independent factor in mortality and more important than stuff on that triad. So the data is there, but we're still missing that key prospective piece.
Right. So like we were saying before, obviously you guys are very effective because you got the protocol, or this included into our transfusion protocol. So if I understand it right, it's 1 gram up front, with 1 gram every 4 units of fresh whole blood specifically, I believe, right?
Yes. For the far forward resuscitation protocol, yes.
Okay. Does it matter whether it's calcium chloride or calcium gluconate?
So does it matter in our setting? No. This is a hot topic, hot debate for a lot of people, and totally understandable why. So chloride is, well, I like to call it the physiologic calcium, but it's ionized calcium. It's going to go, that's what's going to smack the heart and make, you know, protect the myocardium and help kind of reset that myocardium to help it beat better so that we get better perfusion to the tissues. You know, it's going to help drive some of that hyperkalemia down. It's going to push that potassium down that, you know, you see in a hyperkalemic crisis, and hyperkalemia is common in trauma. And it's very rapid, very bioavailable. Some people call it the poor man's presser. I'm sure some of you guys have heard that before. And less is more. So it's just more concentrated as far as milligrams per milliliter of calcium. And then in comparison to gluconate, go back to chloride, there is data to show that is necrotic to tissues if you extravasate the chloride. I know some trauma surgeons I've spoken to who have had to debride chest cavities because of extensive chloride extravasation. So, I mean, there are concerns. It's not 100% a safe drug. However, speaking to some of the experts in the field, like Dr. Kapp, he even says, you know, if we have our patient population who's got, you know, healthy veins and you confirm patency, you can push that calcium slowly and effectively through that vein as long as you know you're in there. Or you could push it IO, especially through something like a sternal IO, and not have too much of a concern. However, switching the script to gluconate, there's no argument against gluconate peripherally that I've had mentioned to me or seen in data. You just have to use 3 to 1 of a ratio. So that's why you'll see the protocol say 1 gram of chloride as opposed to, or 3 grams of gluconate as opposed to 1 gram of chloride. The calcium gluconate does require a potassium to bind to the gluconate, rip it off for the calcium to be released and do its job versus the chloride not needing that process. There was a constant challenge we had where guys would be like, hey, you're saying the liver can't metabolize citrate, but the liver can't metabolize gluconate either. Well, Justin gave me this awesome study that I keep in my back pocket at all times when we're defending our piece of work. There's actually, and I give you full credit because you fed it to me, you spoon fed it to me. There is awesome transplant literature in anhepatic patients, so transplant patients without a liver, who have the same bioavailability of gluconate as patients with a full functioning healthy liver. So the reason gluconate's more favored for the protocol for a lot of guys is, hey, I can push it. I don't have to worry too much about it. I know it's bioavailable. It'll do its job. It's multi-purpose if you look into some of the Seaburn FMs. And on top of that, it's very easy to get on different markets, and there's less of a concern with how you can carry it. So kind of the battalion surgeon's discretion is how we titled the two, if we're going to pick between one or the other.
Okay. No, very good. Now, since since you are definitely a student of mine, you've heard this before, that there's nothing in life is free. And since we do not necessarily have lab capability, definitely not in the field anyway, to monitor administration of these electrolytes, is there any risk of going too far?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, there is. And I just wanted to throw one thing on the last thing before I jump right into that. The only risk, if you want to call it that right now, with calcium gluconate is if you push it too fast, there may be an associated decrease in blood pressure or cause cardiac syncope or something else. So just, if you're going to push it slower. It's not going to get the pressor effect the same way the chloride is.
So when just one quick thing off of that. So since it is kind of time dependent, you know, we kind of cavalierly say slow or fast. So how fast or how slow should we be pushing this?
So the maximum IV rate, as far as I'm tracking for calcium gluconate as per like doctrine, right, is 1 gram in 7 minutes, which seems very, very slow, especially when we're pushing three of them. But that gives you at least kind of an idea. When we say slow push, it's not 15 seconds instead of 10. It's a legitimately slow push.
Okay. Because, like I've seen a lot of guys with TXA do the slow push, and it looks an awful lot like a rapid administration, right?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And that's why I mention it. Just, again, it's not like a guarantee thing, but it is in the literature that it may cause these things. So at least have that in the back of your mind when somebody's pushing it. As far as overcorrection of hypocalcemia, yes, there's absolutely some risk to that. So the McKay study that we cited showed mortality of 78% for patients who became hypercalcemic at any point in their treatment, regardless if they presented hypercalcemic or due to overcorrection by the clinicians. They defined hypercalcemia as greater than 1.25 millimoles per liter. And I'm gonna jump on the argument here before try to nip that in the bud. People are going to look at that McKay study and say, well, that's a low N. Only 9 patients in the study experienced hypercalcemia, 7 of which died, which is a very low number, of course. But then when you look at the entire study as a whole, the entire patient population the sample size for the McKay study was only 42 patients. And that's a regularly studied in this discussion with hypocalcemia management. So 9 patients out of 42 experienced hypercalcemia. That's 22% of those included in the study. So that's the only place that I have found anything in the literature showing hypercalcemia being a risk. None of the other studies address it at all. But if mortality is 78% and just under a quarter of patients experience it, at the bare minimum, it's at least worth being aware of and something that we would also like to look into and potentially research further.
So if hypercalcemia is 1.25 milliosmoles per liter, is that correct?
Millimoles.
Millimoles yeah. per liter?
Mm-hmm.
And what was hypocalcemia?
It's been defined a lot of different ways. Some of the studies define it as less than 1 millimole per liter. Others define it as less than 1.12 millimoles. And then there's one study, I'm forgetting which one off the top of my head, defined it as less than 0.9 millimoles yeah. per liter.
Yeah, that guy was an extremist.
He really liked to go low.
But I mean, if it's maybe it's just me, but those seem like really tight tolerances between hypo and hyper.
They are. It is a tight window.
So, like, how, I guess, I'm probably at most probably going to be carrying 4 vials. Am I going to, with those 4 vials, be able to put somebody into a hypercalcemia?
I think, based off literature, based off expert consultation, I think if you were to slam all 4 of those on a person who wasn't in hemorrhagic shock, maybe. But there's, you put them in a hypercalcemia, you could make them hypercalcemic, but would it be detrimental and increase their mortality in a healthy patient with no trauma? I don't think so. I don't think there'd be true detriment to the body. And I hope any listener can correct that if I'm incorrect there. But in the hemorrhagic shock patient who's requiring transfusion, I think maybe if you rapid pushed all 4 back to back to back without any resuscitation, then maybe. I'm not sure, because there's no like Justin said, we've looked and looked and we constantly are doing lit searches. I think we look for new lit reviews every week, honestly, still at this point. And there's still like no hypercalcemia data as far as dose dependent hypercalcemia. So I think if you're resuscitating your patient and you got to give calcium, just, you know, stick to that protocol. And it's been defined as a reason. And I'll ask Justin, what do you think, man?
Okay. Yeah. So the JDS has written their guidelines for far forward transfusion, knowing that the medic on the ground doesn't have the diagnostic lab capability to really monitor calcium levels. So by giving that unit up front, and then after every 4 units, they're using the JTS is being they, using their expertise in this field, and have determined that that's probably pretty safe. If over half of patients have less than 1.12 right out the gate, they're probably in a pretty good position for it. Now, the guideline goes on to say that once they get back to somewhere that has lab capability, that they're going to monitor ionized calcium levels in the blood and correct to try to keep the value over 1.20 millimoles per liter. Correct me if I'm wrong on that, Ricky.
Nope.
And they're going to be awesome. And they're going to be monitoring that very, very closely. But again, this is something that not a lot of people have talked about. And that's why I'm glad you brought it up. And that's something that needs to be, at least someone needs to be aware that it's out there, especially those that are going to be receiving patients. And we do need to research further, because nobody has really looked into it. And that'll start to give us some better answers and help drive better protocols for the medic on the ground.
Yep, absolutely. You know, knowledge is power, right?
That's right.
So in this kind of the scheme maneuver of hemorrhage control and your TTRC, administration of TXA, getting blood on board, getting calcium on board, I guess, how do I, these drugs are starting to add up on top of my resuscitation as well. So how do I prioritize? Is there any evidence of which is shown to be more effective to push my patient farther down the road?
Ooh, specifically, is there any evidence that, you know, does a cross-sectional analysis to see which one's better? No. And conversations, as far as, and, you know, conversations and data, individual data for each one of those is how we wrote the protocol. And I was lucky enough to be involved in that protocol process.
we kind of came up with economy of motion for the medic on the ground is where we thought. So we wrote it in pieces. So we, at first person, you know, that medic on the ground, like you said, Dennis, vials are adding up. So if it's, hey, it gets sternal or humeral head IO access to confirm, you know, you confirm you got good placement, kind of like that Ranger protocol, don't delay blood. So you can put blood up on board, but if you want to talk economy of motion and get your drugs on board, we've talked about, hey, flush that IO, put your gram of TXA through it, and then you can put your 3 grams of calcium through it, and then you plug your blood right into that spot. And now, as far as being a two-handed provider, you've made the most bang for your buck as far as economy of motion. Now, say you're in a dual provider scenario, and you got 4 hands, hey, get that secondary line and do the slow push better, you know, the good, better, best mentality that you guys bring to the game. You got the dual provider, why not get a secondary line, get the blood on board as fast as possible, and then get your resuscitative adjuncts like calcium and TXA are, and help reduce mortality that way. Or if you're in the role one setting and you have, or you're in a fixed facility, I don't want to say just role one, and you have ability to do central line, why, it's like, why not? If you can do the best medicine, do the best medicine. So like we're talking about for that ground medic, you know, get that line, your two-hand provider, get your drugs on board, and get your blood going. And then that way you can move on with the rest of your assessment, or you can continue to resuscitate your patient and not move on until they're resuscitated. But Justin, you have any better insight on that?
No, like you said, it's a tough question to answer, right? Because there's a lot of question marks around it. We don't know. We know that TXA, you know, the crash studies have shown that it definitely decreases risk of death due to bleeding, right? And the crash 2 specifically really laid that out. We know that low levels of calcium are associated with higher mortality. And then the Kyle study out of the UK showed that early administration of calcium in a pre-hospital environment with blood products given concurrently absolutely prevented, to a certain extent, hypocalcemia, right?
Yeah, so, and reduced the amount of blood.
Absolutely. And so, you know, it's far saying, like, is one more important than another? Now you get into that kind of hard to answer. We don't have a cross-sectional analysis or anything of the sort. But you should be getting 2 lines anyway, and you're not going to push TXA or scheme through a bloodline. So, because that line started administering these.
The way I'm starting to look at it is a little more on the logistics side. So Shackelford's study shows that blood on board at best is within 30 minutes of injury. Okay, so hopefully you have blood on board or already taken with you, so it's ready to go. But if it's not, you have to draw it from somebody and administer it within 30 minutes. TXA, as it is right now, has to be administered over 10 minutes. And now calcium, you know, administered ideally 7 minutes, okay, slow push, right? So, I mean, for the things to happen, I mean, we're already outside of the window of that 30 minutes if we're doing, you know, TXA, calcium, or flip-flop, either or, and then some kind of blood administration, because you know people are going to look at it, you know, M in March, so, you know, TXA stops bleeding, which it doesn't really do, but people think of it as doing that. You know, then they think about it too algorithmically, so I was hoping that, you know, is there something that say, hey, you know, TXA is good, but it's not going to help the guy for another hour. Till that clot actually stabilizes, that's when you're going to see your effects. It doesn't cause a clot, it stabilizes clots. You know, calcium can help now by forming a clot to begin with. Blood has to go on, and that has the highest priority in my mind. I could be 100% wrong, but the way I like to explain to people is you need 2 lines. Just be a big boy and get 2 lines, either 2 IVs or 2 IOs. I really don't care how you get it in them. Get it in them. Start the blood running now. And these things like calcium, would be going next, TXA chasing soon after that. Am I way off?
No, I started a little bit there. The one thing I want, like that you said, that's really awesome, is that you ask really good questions, and that's the whole point of research, is asking a good scientific question. Like we asked initially, hey, does TXA reduce mortality? And then you answer that question with the crash trials, and then you have Dennis DeRamo, who's like, great, but what's the perfect timing of TXA against blood or versus calcium? Like that's another whole project, because you got to ask those questions. I don't think you're far off, Dennis. I really don't. And especially, like you said, for those guys out there who don't get to carry blood or in a situation where they can't, you know, it averages about, you know, Justin, you can correct me here too, you know, 10 to 15 minutes to draw a single unit of blood off of one guy that's well hydrated, you know, and has some good flow going. And during that time, yes, you could set up your secondary line. You can start your resuscitative adjuncts while you're drawing your blood. You know, this is a whole another logistical and management thing that you need to be well trained in and be able to handle. But in the fight against calcium versus blood, which one comes first? I mean, calcium doesn't carry oxygen. You know, it doesn't carry nutrients. It doesn't have any type of immune, you know, support. What does it do though? It fights at the receptor sites to help the clotting cascade. It helps kick hydrogen off, because hydrogen will bind to the sites where calcium is supposed to bind, and which helps, the hydrogen will bind to where calcium is supposed to bind, which is why the clotting is prolonged. But calcium is going to squeeze from its inotropic effect on the heart, and it's going to help fix a lot of those receptor sites and help the cascade. But whole blood is whole blood. And we have a ton of data from the last 10 years of war, or sorry, 20, pardon me, the last 20, in our beautiful registry, if we do a retrospective analysis that shows early admission of whole blood reduces mortality significantly. At what point that we're at is we're trying to become surgical at the point of injury by, you know, being perfect or being that much better. So we know whole blood is going to help keep that patient alive, and we have resuscitative adjuncts that help keep them alive even more. Well, until we have that, you know, prognostic data, but you get what I'm saying. So I agree with you, Dennis, on your theory. If I had nothing and I could only pick one, I'm going to pick blood. If I had nothing and I couldn't pick blood and all I had was crystalloids, I'm picking calcium. If that makes sense.
I can jump in and throw a couple of things as well. So
please.
Your theory there, Dennis, at least passes the initial sniff test, but I don't think any of us are confident saying yes, because there's nothing really to support it. We know that the early administration of calcium with blood products decreases hypocalcemia, like I mentioned before with the Kyle study. And so at least initially getting that on board early seems important. The calcium is going to help form that clot, as somebody who is lacking that calcium, which is a necessary binding site in different parts all throughout the clotting cascade, is going to help form that clot. Whereas TXA is going to stabilize it, like you had mentioned. We do know from the CRASH II study that early treatment, which they identified as less than or equal to 1 hour from injury, significantly reduced the risk of death to bleeding. And that those treatment given between 1 and 3 hours also reduced the risk, though not as much. And then anything outside of 3 hours increased the risk of death due to bleeding, as far as administration of TXA. So knowing those numbers, you could make the argument that you have more time until you have to give the TXA, as long as you're within that hour, to really get that significantly reduced risk of bleeding, is the word that they use.
Right.
But that's the basic like sniff test as far as having a true answer. You know, yes, this, then this, then this. We're all trying to answer that too. Calcium, given at the point of injury, is still so new that, you know, we're working to find them.
Yeah, I mean, things have developed leaps and bounds over what they were. You know, my first tour was in 2003. We were barely having tourniquets. We didn't have the tourniquets that we do now for certain. And now it's, you know, TXA on the battlefield, calcium, whole blood on the battlefield. So I think, just from being an instructor at the course, just having that physiology behind you and actually learn it and try to remember it gives you the background or baseline knowledge to be able to make decisions that are going to affect your patient's life.
Yeah, absolutely.
Most definitely.
Is there anything else you guys would like to talk about that I missed?
No, not as far as that you missed at all, Dennis. I think you covered a lot of good stuff. Just for listeners to know that our working group, the little Lethal Diamond working group, we are working on some real world research. We're constantly working with other people that want to do the research themselves. It's a very hot topic. Understand the common denominator of all the papers have almost a word-for-word same conclusion, which is a multi-center, randomized, double-blind prospective study is what we're lacking as a community across the world, as a whole community in medicine. That's what we're lacking. And we're trying to fix that problem. And if anybody else would like to help us fix that problem and you have a means to do research, you know, please contact us. That'd be awesome. Justin, you got anything?
No, that's pretty much it. I really appreciate appreciate you having us on so we can talk about this. And I look forward to hearing or reading any listeners' questions. If there's anything that really stands out or anything they want to contribute to the discussion as well, and I know we would all love to hear it. And, you know, hopefully try to at least get this information out there and start to answer some of these questions as of them. And more people asking questions like you were asking, Dennis, just makes everyone that much better by trying to really, like you said, look at the physiology and get the research to back it so we can know for certain what we're doing is the best for the patient.
Cool, man. Hey, I really appreciate you guys coming on.
No, thanks for having us, man. It was awesome.
Yeah, thank you.
That's it for today's podcast. Be sure to go to our website, www.prolongfieldcare.org. Find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram. Subscribe and stay on the bleeding edge of combat medicine. This is Dennis for the PFC Podcast. Out. Every boy is waiting there for you.